roughly, it fits well into the latter part of this definition. So Eric Nelson, our guest of honor for today, is a professor of government at Harvard University. He received his AB summa cum laude from Harvard University and a PhD from the University of Cambridge. And he has been awarded fellowship by the Guggenheim Memorial Foundation and the American Council of Learned Society. He was also he has also been a junior fellow at the Harvard Society of Fellows, a fellow of Trinity College, Cambridge, and a British Marshall Scholar. His essays have appeared in a wide range of scholarly journals, and his first book, The Greek Tradition in Republican Thought, was published in 2004 by Cambridge University Press. The book which he will discuss with us here today, The Hebrew Republic, Jewish Sources and the Transformation of European Political Thought, was published in 2010 by Harvard and received the Laura Shannon Prize in Contemporary European Studies and was also named a Choice Outstanding Academic Title of 2010. Before I will allow Professor Nelson to actually present the book, I want to read to you two short excerpts that were written about the book. The first of which is by Professor Michael Walzer of the Institute for Advanced Legal Studies, who writes, Eric Nelson's deep knowledge of the Hebrew, as well as the Greek and Latin sources of 16th and 17th century political thought, is brilliantly deployed in this book. Nelson provides a provocative and persuasive account of the remarkable effect of taking biblical and rabbinical texts seriously. Daniel Friedman, not our own Daniel Friedman, spelled differently as well, writes at Forbes the following words. Many of the political freedoms that we enjoy today have their roots in the Hebrew Bible and the rabbinical commentaries that explain it. Eric Nelson outlines this in his brilliant new book, The Hebrew Republic, showing, for example, how the triumph of the republican government over monarchy is in large part thanks to the Bible and the rabbis. So with this premise, I give you Professor Eric Nelson.
Well, after that promise, I shouldn't talk. Thank you. Well, thank you very much to Professor Dagan and to the Institute for inviting me. Thank you, first and foremost, to all of you for coming and for allowing me to impose upon you by doing this in English. But I know that your English is much better than my Hebrew, so we'll do it that way. And I appreciate your indulgence. So I thought I would begin with a story in order to set the mood for what I'm going to say. And it's a story about John Selden, who was, as some of you might know, the most famous learned man in 17th century England. He was a lawyer and parliamentarian, one of the leading political figures of the day, but also the most outstanding and admired English man of letters of the 17th century. Selden, in 1629, was arrested on orders from Charles I for denying the king's authority to dissolve Parliament, and he was sent to the Tower of London. Initially, he was forbidden to have any books with him in his cell. But some months later, the king softened the terms of Selden's imprisonment and allowed him to designate a very small number of books to keep with him in his cell. If we were thinking about what someone like John Selden in 1629 might have asked to have with him during his imprisonment, if he was only allowed a very small number of books, we might think he asked for Homer or Virgil or even the Bible. He was a lawyer, so you might have thought he would have asked for Bracton or something like that. But in fact, we have his letter to his jailers in which he says, just please bring me the Babylonian and Palestinian Talmuds. That's what I want with me in my cell. So really, what I'm going to talk about today is the significance and consequence of that fact, that an extraordinary Orthodox Protestant scholar in the 17th century felt so strongly about the importance of studying the rabbis that he would have chosen the Talmud as his desert island book. I mean, as the only one that he could bring with him into his cell. And the sort of fact that that's what he did, I think, is an eloquent testimony to the power of the phenomenon that I'm going to be talking about, which is the rise of what has been called Christian Hebraism, beginning in the late 15th century, but really reaching its pinnacle in the late 16th and then 17th centuries. And then, in turn, what that story means for how we tell the history of political thought in the European West. To begin with, we should say something, just very briefly, about how that story is ordinarily told, and particularly how it's ordinarily told in relation to the history of religion and the history of theology. Because as many of you will know, the standard way of telling the story of how political thought in the West and political philosophy in the West become modern is to tell a story about secularization. And that is the idea that in the pre-Renaissance period, in the sort of medieval and then early Renaissance period, political thought in Europe is still fundamentally Christian. It exists in a Christian intellectual universe and is deeply theologized. So the way you ask questions about politics is to ask questions about God. That is, how does God want us to live? You then sort of proceed in that fashion to derive a godly or religiously appropriate form of political life from a set of authoritative sources, chiefly scripture, but also the major sources of Christian theology, the fathers of the church, and so on. And the usual way of telling the story is this is how things more or less proceed through the scholastic period and then into the early Renaissance, until when you hit the 16th century, things begin to change. And in the 16th century, and whoever is telling the story will tell it slightly differently, and they'll emphasize different factors and characteristics of the intellectual world of the period that they want to focus on. But in general, they'll talk about the wars of religion, the rise of the new science, the massive popularity of philosophical skepticism beginning in the 16th century. And they'll talk about how this sort of complex of factors convinced European theorists to initiate something that is sometimes called the Great Separation, to sort of sequester moral and political theory from theology and religion on the grounds that religious claims are now thought to be not only of dubious authority and reliability, but also incredibly dangerous from the point of view of civil peace. And so the solution is to sort of put religion to one side and create an autonomous way of doing moral philosophy and political science that doesn't rely on foundational claims drawn from religion and theology, such that these disciplines can now be said to be secular, that is to rely only on reason and other kinds of sources to generate an approach to moral and political life that doesn't have to resort to divisive and seemingly dangerous religious propositions. So that's the usual way in which this story has been told. And one of the things that I wanted to suggest in the book was that there is at least a very important sense in which that way of telling the story gets things backwards. That is, if you look at Renaissance political thought, if you look at the way in which humanists, for example, thought about political science, what you find is actually a very, very secular approach to the discipline. The humanists, after all, for all their differences amongst themselves and with each other, were all involved in some way in the project of ancient recovery. That is, they were reviving the intellectual worlds of Greece and Rome, and their way of doing political science was fundamentally indebted to classical sources. And for that reason, it made virtually no recourse to revelation or to important texts in the patristic or scholastic traditions. That isn't to say that Italian humanists were not pious Christians. Most of them were, some of them were not. But if you read the works of political theory written by the likes of Leonardo Bruni or Petrarch or Niccolò Machiavelli or Guicciardini or whomever, you find virtually nothing about religion, certainly almost nothing in the way of scriptural citation. These are theorists who studied political science by studying Aristotle and Cicero, by studying Greek and Roman history, and they really didn't make any substantial recourse to religious texts or claims in doing political science. And the discipline really got on perfectly well without the sort of religious apparatus that we're usually led to expect. What changes all of this is actually the Reformation. And when we get into the 16th century, and then particularly as the Reformation fragments, proliferates, and develops in the 17th century, we get a very, very different approach to political science, which begins fundamentally with a different approach to what we call the Hebrew Bible, what they would have called the Old Testament. So in the previous period, of course, the standard way of thinking, if you were a Christian, about the Hebrew Bible was that it was the old law that had been abrogated by the coming of the gospel. The new dispensation had replaced the old. And there was very little reason, religiously, theologically, for Christians to concern themselves with the text of the Hebrew Bible. The text was read, of course, typologically. That is, it was read as authenticating the Gospels by prefiguring or prophesying events in the life of Jesus. So the binding of Isaac prefigures the crucifixion, the flood is a symbol of baptism, or whatever. But the moral law, which is present in the Decalogue, was regarded as also present in the Gospel, and by some as perfected in the Gospel. The dietary and ceremonial laws were simply regarded as void. And so there was actually very little reason for Christians to be particularly interested in the sort of great drama captured in the Hebrew Bible. But with the new Protestant emphasis on Scripture, the Lutheran cry of sola scriptura, that a Christian should seek salvation only through the Bible, that every Christian should study the Bible, and that for that reason one should learn the biblical languages, Greek for the Gospels and Hebrew for the Old Testament, produced a wave of fascination with the text of the Hebrew Bible and biblical scholarship. It's also the period at which we get the first professors of Hebrew at all of the major European universities, in Oxford and Cambridge, in Leiden, in Franeker and the Netherlands, in Paris, in Spanish universities, and so on. So we get the first generation of professional Christian Hebraists, that is, Christians whose job it is not only to teach Hebrew in universities, but to produce Hebrew grammars and lexica, teaching aids, and also to begin to translate Hebrew texts, first texts dealing with the Bible itself and its grammar, but later the full corpus of rabbinic literature into Latin. So by the end of the 17th century, virtually the entire corpus of rabbinic literature has been translated into Latin. The entire Mishnah, at least 15 tractates of the Talmud, the works of Maimonides, of course the Maimonides' guide, the Mora Nebuchim, had been translated earlier, much earlier, but the Mishnah Torah is translated into Latin, and works by Abravanel and Ibn Ezra, Yehuda Halevi, the whole sort of panoply of sources is now available in Latin to the Christian West. And the preoccupations that produce this phenomenon are first and foremost philological. That is the first priority for the Protestant writers. And there are some very important Catholic Hebraists, but this is by and large a Protestant phenomenon. And in fact, as Protestants are getting more and more interested in Hebrew sources in the late 16th and 17th century, Catholics are getting less and less interested. That is, as the Council of Trent decides that the Vulgate Bible is the Bible from the point of view of church dogma and practice, and that there is no Christian reason to study the biblical text in its original languages. That, of course, has an enormous effect on the intellectual world of Catholic countries. And Catholic hostility to the Talmud, in particular, develops very rapidly through the 16th century. So the first published edition of the Talmud in the early 16th century is actually published under a papal imprimatur by Leo X. But by the 1550s, of course, the Talmud is being publicly burned, and then the Sisto-Clementine Index bans all editions of the Talmud, even those that had been purged of the heretical bits by censors. So as all of this is heating up in the Protestant world, it is cooling down in the Catholic world. So it is by and large a Protestant phenomenon. So the first priority is to read the biblical text and for purposes of the Christian ministry. But gradually, the project begins to vary and to deepen as these writers begin to sort of read the Hebrew Bible differently. Instead of seeing it simply as an old law that's been replaced by the new, and instead of seeing it simply as a sort of typological or prophetic prefigurement of the events of the Gospels, they begin to see it actually as a political constitution, as the constitution of a republic that God himself had ordered and designed for his chosen people before they fell from grace. And since he never did this again, that is, as these writers pointed out over and over again, Jesus had given no law. So the only time that the perfect and omniscient God had ever produced the blueprint of a constitution was this one time for what began to be called the Respublica Hebraeorum, the Republic of the Hebrews, or the Hebrew Republic. And it was therefore authoritative in some way for Christians. Although these laws, of course, were no longer obligatory as such on Christians, they were nonetheless exemplary. And so this was a way of carving a sort of middle ground in the Christian view of the Hebrew Bible. So, of course, these writers would still say most of the Mosaic law had been simply voided, the dietary laws, the ritual purity laws, the laws of sacrifice and so on. Those were just gone. But and of course, the moral law had been perfected or was simply the same. But there was this additional category that they identified of political laws, judicial laws, which were neither abrogated nor obligatory. They were in the middle. They were authoritative, exemplary, interesting in some way for Christians. But of course, the problem was if you were a Christian and you were interested in figuring out how the Hebrew Republic worked just from reading the text of the Bible, you would find this very difficult. What the Bible has to say about these institutions, as you know, is very fragmentary, also very contradictory in places. And so these writers gradually began to turn to rabbinic sources, the same rabbinic sources that had now been translated into Latin, so you could read this stuff even if you knew no Hebrew, or even if your Hebrew was sort of mediocre. And they would turn to these sources to reconstruct the practices and institutions of this divinely authorized constitution, the Hebrew Republic. Now, this didn't mean, of course, I should say, and I should stress, that they liked Jews. They didn't like them at all. And in fact, with very few exceptions, actually John Selden, whom I mentioned at the beginning, seems to have been a genuine exception. I mean, if you're interested in identifying a 17th century Philo-Semite, it would be John Selden. But for the most part, they didn't like Jews at all. And they would apologize at the beginning of these texts that they were writing. They would say, look, very sorry that I have to tax your patience by taking you through the rabbis, who are, of course, apologists for deicide and beneath our notice in most ways, but it's sort of all we have. You know, I mean, if you want to understand this constitution, you have to ask them, because it's the only evidence that we have, and so we'll now sort of turn to these texts in order to reconstruct the story. And what this gives rise to is arguably the most dominant single genre of political writing in Protestant Europe for 100 years, from the publication of the first one of these in 1574 through to Spinoza's Tractatus Theologico-Politicus, which is just in the same genre, but at the other end of that century. This whole set of texts called De Republica Hebraeorum, on the Hebrew Republic, or on the Constitution of Moses, or on the Jewish polity, or whatever. There were, as I say, at least 100 of these. And that list is actually conservative because there are many texts that weren't actually called that, that nonetheless were, in effect, studies of the Hebrew Republic. And virtually every major political theorist in the Protestant world in the 17th century produced one of these. So Hugo Grotius produced one, James Harrington in England produced one, Thomas Hobbes produced one, and then, of course, Spinoza. And although Locke himself didn't produce a formal treatise, there are large sections of the Lockean corpus that are very indebted to this tradition and are, in effect, his version of it. So this is actually an enormously sort of dominant and varied phenomenon. And really what the book was about is was to try to understand what difference this made in the history of European political thought, particularly the political thought of the 17th century, and how it altered how Europeans thought about politics. And I focus on three dimensions in which European thought is very straightforwardly, I think, inflected and then transformed by this encounter with rabbinic sources. Rabbinic sources sometimes very badly misunderstood, by the way, but nonetheless, still very powerfully present in the debates. I'm only going to talk about one of them for the remainder of this talk because I want to open it up for discussion. The two I won't talk about are, first and foremost, the question of the redistribution of wealth, and particularly the redistribution of land. And here there was really a major departure because in the Republican tradition in particular, which was very inflected by the study of Roman sources, European writers learned from their Roman authorities, chiefly from Cicero, but also from virtually the entire surviving corpus of Latin authors, that the most famous attempt at the redistribution of land in antiquity, the Roman agrarian laws, proposed by the Gracchi, had been not only terribly unjust, but so dangerous and politically stupid that it had brought about the collapse of the Roman Republic and the rise of Caesar. And so the view about these measures in European political theory, particularly among Republican writers, was very, very gloomy. What changes all of that, I suggest, is this meditation on biblical land law, particularly the Yovel, and the sort of distribution of land that's mandated in the Hebrew Bible, as commented on by rabbinic sources, chiefly Maimonides, who then sort of prompt these Christian writers to rethink the question, because the most famous of this set of writers, Peter Cuneus, who was from the Netherlands. As he's writing his study of the Hebrew Republic, he looks at the land laws and he says, but these are just agrarian laws, like the Roman ones. And if that's true, that is, if God, who is perfect, had designed laws like that in his perfect commonwealth, then Cicero had to be wrong. And so that meant you had to rethink the whole thing, as they did. The other major issue, which I won't talk about, is religious toleration, although we might want to talk about that in the discussion, where, again, our usual way of thinking about toleration is to suppose that toleration goes along with religious skepticism. That is, the less sure you are that you're right, the more likely you will be to tolerate heterodox opinions in others. And there's a sort of intuitive sense in which that seems as if it should be true, but it isn't. in the early modern period. And in fact, the most passionate defenses of toleration were religious in character rather than skeptical. Here again, the particular understanding of how religious belief was either governed or actually not governed in the Hebrew Republic, refracted through these rabbinic writings, convinced a wide range of European theorists who were in favor of state churches, that is, who were not in favor of separating church and state, but bringing them together, subjecting the church to the civil magistrate, convinced these people that God's divinely authorized polity had practiced toleration. And that then led to the first major defenses of religious toleration in the European tradition, sweeping through the 17th century. But I'm not going to talk about those. For the remainder of my talk right now, I'm going to talk about the third sort of shift, and that has to do with political science itself, the idea of political science and what it's about and how we should think about it. Because these writers in the 17th century were inheriting a tradition of political thought that was, to this degree, perfectly Aristotelian. That is, the idea of what we might call constitutional pluralism. The idea, as many of you will know from having read your Aristotle, is that there are several correct, legitimate constitutional forms. You can have the good version of the rule of one, the good version of the rule of a few, and the good version of the rule of many, monarchy, aristocracy, or polity, what would later be translated as republic. And then you can have the bad versions of all of those, tyranny, oligarchy, democracy. Right, where democracy is the bad version of the rule of the many, which is just really the rule of the poor, right, in their own interests. So the idea is political science is not one size fits all. Different cities, different nationalities will have different constitutions, and that's right. There are some constitutions that are better suited for people over here, some better suited for people over there. You might even take the view that there was a single constitution that was best. Best in all circumstances. But the others were still acceptable, still legal and legitimate. So if you were a Republican in the period before the 17th century, what that meant was you took the view that kingless government was better than monarchy, and that for various reasons you should prefer it. That's certainly the view taken by the sort of civic humanists in the Italian tradition. But none of those people had any interest in denying the legitimacy of monarchy. Monarchy remained a legitimate, perfectly acceptable constitution that you shouldn't choose because it's not as good as the one you should choose, which is the Republican constitution on that view. And incidentally, that was true on the other side of monarchists. That is, monarchists would take the view that you should have a monarch and that monarchy is better. But it wouldn't have dawned on a monarchical political theorist writing in France to deny that the Venetian constitution was legitimate. That was not how these humanist writers thought about politics. So this changes for the first time, again, in exactly this period, and in large measure due to the encounter with rabbinic sources, because at issue is the question of how to understand biblical monarchy. The moment in the story of the Hebrew Bible when the Israelites ask for a king. And as you know, there are two important passages here, one in Deuteronomy 17 and the second in 1 Samuel 8. And at least on the straight reading, they seem to contradict each other, or at least to be very dissonant with each other. So in Deuteronomy, God says to the people, look, when you enter the land of Israel, you will. It's going to happen that you're going to say, we want a king. And at that point, he seems to say, that's okay, fine, have a king, but just make sure he's the right kind of king. And then the text goes on to identify the sorts of things that a king shouldn't do. First of all, he must be an Israelite, the sort of king whom the Lord will choose. He shouldn't multiply horses and women and do other sort of naughty things. But in general, fine, have a king. Then, of course, you get to 1 Samuel 8, and the prophesied moment occurs. The people ask for a king, and both God and Samuel get very angry. So the question for Christian exegetes, going back to the fathers of the church, was how do you put these together? How do you make them harmonious? And there were two major ways of doing it, but by far the most common was to say, well, look, when the Israelites asked for a king in 1 Samuel 8, they sinned. But the sin wasn't asking for a king. It was asking for the wrong kind of king. Because the actual language that they use, as you know, is we want a king, kichol hagoyim sivotenu. We want a king like the kings of the nations around us. So that meant a Gentile kind of king. And a king who would be lordly and tyrannical, the wrong kind of king. That's why it was a sin. So the sin was asking for a king unlike the sort of king described in Deuteronomy. And there were other ways of squaring the circle, but that was by far the most common one. So the idea is you put them together and you say kingship is acceptable. God allows you to have a king. So Deuteronomy 17 is the permission. And then in 1 Samuel 8 it happens, and we know what the sin is, and the sin is not that they asked for a king. So when the rabbinic sources come into this debate, they radicalize the view on both sides. Because first, the Christian writers discover the Talmud, and they discover the discussion in Masechet Sanhedrin on this passage. Remember the context in the discussion. The rabbis are arguing about whether what Samuel goes on to say after the people ask for a king. Samuel goes on to describe all the terrible things that a king is going to do if they have one. And he's going to take your sons for his soldiers, he'll take your women, he'll take your fields and your vineyards. So the question was, is this halakha? That is it the case that these are actually the rights of the king? Or is this passage, what the rabbis called the Parashat HaMelech, you know, this passage about kings that Samuel offers, is it just designed to scare them? Is it just a way of saying, look, the king is going to be terrible, this is why you shouldn't want one? Or is Samuel saying, be careful about having a king, because if you have one, the king will have the right to do these things? And that, so those were that was the question. And so there is this rabbinic discussion. But the major position that's attributed first to Rabbi Yehuda, but then to Rabbi Eliezer ben Sadok, is even stronger. It says, actually, when the in Deuteronomy 17, this pasuk is not actually a permission or a prophecy. It's not saying if you ask for a king or when you ask for a king, you can have one. It's saying when you enter the land, you must say, let us have a king. That is, it's a mitzvah to ask for a monarch. And they do this through some wordplay, as those of you who know the text will know. But what this allows the rabbis in the Talmud to do is to class the mitzvah of asking for a king, which is required now, not just permitted, but required, along with two other commandments pertaining to the conquest of the land. When you enter the land, you must ask for a king, build the temple, and destroy Amalek. And those are the three mitzvot that have to do with coming into the land. And so, for the Talmud, this is now required. Well, when Protestant theorists discover this passage, it goes viral. It's suddenly in every major Protestant biblical commentary. I thought I'd read you just a passage from one, a very famous one, by Sebastian Münster, who was a Hebraist, very important biblical scholar. He was also the man who taught John Calvin his Hebrew. And his gloss on Deuteronomy 17 on this this pasuk is the following. It says, the Hebrews observed that there were three commandments for the Israelites when they were going to enter the promised land, namely to constitute a king over them, to wipe out the seed of Amalek, and to build a temple for the Lord. The Hebrews also posed this question. Why did the Lord react with anger because they asked for a king in the time of Samuel, when in this place, that is, in Devarim, in Deuteronomy, he either commands or creates a right to constitute one? Some respond to this, that the elders who lived at the time did not ask for a king wickedly and impiously when they said to Samuel, give us a king who can judge us, but rather that the mob, the Amei Ha'aretz, as the Talmud says, sinned because they did not wish to listen to the voice of Samuel, but said, by no means, but let there be a king over us so that we may be like the other nations. So that's just a straightforward paraphrase of the discussion in Sanhedrin, where actually Rabbi Eleazar argues that there were two requests for a king. The virtuous one, the Zakenim, the elders, said, we want a king just to judge us, and then the ordinary people said, no, we want a king, Kichol HaGoyim. So he's just reading it out. And virtually all of the major Protestant biblical commentators would follow him. But there was, of course, another very important rabbinic discussion of this moment, the request for a king, not in the Talmud, but in the Midrash, in the Midrash Rabbah, in Devarim Rabbah. And that, too, had been excerpted and substantially translated in Latin by the 1620s. And I'm not going to read out the discussion because it's long and somewhat elliptical, but basically, the rabbis of the Midrash take almost the opposite view, equally radical, but in the other direction. They say, no, Deuteronomy 17 is neither a mitzvah nor a permission. It's just a prophecy. God is just saying, look, this is what's going to happen. You're going to ask for a king. And this is a prophecy of sin. God is saying, look, at some point you're going to sin in asking for a king. And then the punishment for that sin is monarchy. They're punished by being given what they asked for. And ultimately this will lead to the galut. That's the theory. So what is the sin? Why is it a sin to ask for a king? Not the wrong kind of king, not a king like all the other nations, but just any king. Why is that a sin? And the answer to the question is because it's idolatry. As the Midrash, using the euphemism of Avodat Kochavim, but it's idolatry because you're bowing down to a flesh and blood man instead of the true king, who is God. And so having a mortal king is the sin of idolatry and therefore illicit. So this reading, glossing the same passages and focusing in particular on the words that Samuel uses when the people ask for a king, Samuel gets very angry, and then God says to Samuel, don't be angry at them, it's not you they've rejected, but me in asking for a king. So the Midrash reads this literally to mean when they asked for a mortal king, they were rejecting the kingship of God and engaging in idolatry. So that reading then also goes viral, but in different sources. So you get the monarchists, radicalized by the Talmudic reading, who start to argue that monarchy is required by God. You must have a monarch, because Scripture tells us that we have to. Then you get the people on the other side, arguing actually that monarchy is forbidden, because it is sin. And not only forbidden to the Jews or to the Israelites, because idolatry, as they all agreed, is equally a sin for Christians. So suddenly monarchy is out of the picture. This all gets going because of a single text, basically. I mean, the ones who knew Hebrew very well, and there was a very small number of those, were able to read these texts in the original. But for everybody else, they all relied on a little book that was published in 1625 by someone called Wilhelm Schickard. Has anyone ever heard of Wilhelm Schickard? I was hoping there was a computer scientist in the room. Because the computer scientists know about Wilhelm Schickard. He's most famous because he has a plausible claim to being the inventor of the computer. He actually created a counting machine that's thought to have been the first computer. But he was also a Hebraist and a professor of Oriental languages at Tübingen. And he writes a little book, which he gives a Hebrew title, Mishpat HaMelech, then in Latin, Jus Regium Hebraeorum, the rights of Hebrew kingship. And he is a monarchist. So he wants to tell you the laws of Hebrew kingship. But in the introduction, he says, first of all, we have to settle a question, namely whether the Bible likes monarchy or it doesn't. And he says, he cites the Talmud, and he says, actually, yes, of course, not only is monarchy okay, but the rabbis I agree with tell us that it's a mitzvah, it's a commandment, and that everyone should have a monarch. But in this sort of amazing moment of intellectual honesty, he says, well, look, I have to admit that there are some rabbis who take the other view. And he then lists them, not only the Midrash itself, but also those rabbis who were influenced by the Midrash, Bachya ben Asher and others, although interestingly not Abravanel. And that's a sort of interest. So Abravanel, although he would be an obvious person to bring in here, does not appear in these discussions until much, much later. So, but Schickard also makes a mistake that they all make. So no one, and this makes it very confusing, no one in the 17th century ever talks about the Midrash. When they're citing the Midrash, when they're quoting it verbatim, as Schickard does, they say they're quoting a figure called Rabba Bar Nachmoni. So you look at this and you say, what are they talking about, Rabba Bar Nachmoni? And you realize that they made an understandable mistake. And the mistake is they knew that the title of the work is Midrash Rabbah, right? But instead of understanding that this means the great Midrash, they think it means the Midrash by somebody called Rabbah. So now they have to figure out a Rabbah who could have written it, and they find this figure, Rabbah Bar Nachmoni, who is a Tana, I guess. And then so he becomes the author. So Grotius and Selden, all of them, whenever they're talking about the Midrash and they're citing it, they say, this is Bar Nachmon. So that's part of the confusion. But it's the Midrash. So this now is reproduced in Schickard. And Schickard gets read by quite a lot of people. The most important one is John Milton. Uses this argument for the first time in a text he writes in 1651, his first defense of the English people. He's defending the regicide, that is, the execution of Charles I in 1649. And in his first texts on the regicide, he had been content just to say, look, I don't have any problem with monarchy. I think monarchy is less good than a republican constitution, but monarchy is fine. All we have to argue is that if your king becomes a tyrant, you're allowed to rebel against him and punish him. But now he begins to move in a very different direction, and he actually engages in a debate with an opponent of his who cited the Talmud, and he says, look, I want to focus on this other argument. There are these rabbis who say that when the Israelites asked for a king, this was a sin, and it was the sin of idolatry, and therefore monarchy is unacceptable. And I follow the opinion of these rabbis, he says. And having said that, he then proceeds to gloss 1 Samuel 8 in the Midrashic manner, I mean, virtually quoting it. So I thought I would just read what he says. I've translated out of the Latin, but this is what he says. God indeed gives great evidence throughout of his great displeasure at the Israelite request for a king. Thus, in Samuel 8, verse 7, they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them according to all the works which they have done, wherewith they have forsaken me and served other gods. The meaning is that it is a form of idolatry to ask for a king who demands that he must be worshipped and granted honors like those of a god. Indeed, he who sets an earthly master over him and above all the laws is near to establishing a strange god for himself, one seldom reasonable, usually a brute beast, who has scattered reason to the winds. Thus in Samuel we read, "And you have this day rejected your God, who himself saved you out of all your adversities and your tribulation, and you've said unto him, Nay, but set a king over us." Just as if he had been teaching them that it was not for any man, but for God alone to rule over men. When at last the Jewish people came to their senses, they complained in Isaiah 26 that it had been ruinous for them to have kings other than God. This evidence all proves that the Israelites were given a king by God in his wrath. Okay? So that's the argument. Milton continues to make it all the way through. And it's then picked up by all of the other Commonwealth writers in the 1650s. James Harrington, Algernon Sidney, John Cook, all the rest. They just all make it. So the Republican persuasion becomes completely radicalized. And they understand what's happening. In fact, Harrington has a wonderful discussion where he says, look, this has become a debate amongst rabbis. You know, this group has their rabbis, and we have our rabbis. And our rabbis are Bar Nachman, and Nachmanides, and Bachya ben Asher, and their rabbis are Maimonides, and the Talmud, and all the rest. And our rabbis are right, and their rabbis are wrong. And it's all a question about how to read Deuteronomy 17, whether you should read it as a permission, if you ask for a king, okay, or as a commandment, when you enter the land, ask for a king, you must, right? And so they know exactly what's going on. It gets picked up, and the argument is made over and over again in a number of pamphlets, and I thought I would just end by reading you an excerpt of one of them. This author writes as follows. Government by kings was first introduced into the world by the heathens, from whom the children of Israel copied the custom. It was the most prosperous invention the devil ever set on foot for the promotion of idolatry. The heathens paid divine honors to their deceased kings, and the Christian world hath improved on the plan by doing the same to their living ones. How impious is the title of sacred majesty applied to a worm, who in the midst of his splendor is crumbling into dust. Near 3,000 years passed away from the Mosaic account of the creation till the Jews, under a national delusion, requested a king. Till then, their form of government, except in extraordinary cases where the Almighty interposed, was a kind of republic, administered by judges and the elders of the tribes. Kings had they none, and it was held sinful to acknowledge any being under that title but the Lord of hosts. And when a man seriously reflects on the idolatrous homage which is paid to the persons of kings, he need not wonder that the Almighty, ever jealous of his honor, should disapprove of a form of government which so impiously invades the prerogatives of heaven. Well, some of you might recognize the language. It was in fact written not by Milton or his group, but 100 years later, by another Englishman, an emigre to North America, who was named Thomas Paine, and he called his reflections common sense. So thank you.
Thank you so much. The next episode, for the next episode, those of you who speak only English are kindly required to use your earphones. Our next speaker, the commentator for today, is Professor Arye Edrei. He studied at the Hebrew and did his postdoctoral degree at Harvard University and then came to the capital of Tel Aviv. He's been a visiting professor at numerous places abroad, published widely. His rather famous book is Split Jewish Diaspora, written with Doron Mendels, and he's an expert both in the Zionist responses to Judaism and the Jewish responses to the contemporary existential predicament of an independent state. Arye will speak in Hebrew and you will understand why as he goes further.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Where do we get them from?
Hey, thank you very much, Manoch. I'll say a few words in English. thank you very much, Professor Nelson, for this fascinating book and beautiful introduction. You know, I read the book through the lens of someone who has to comment on the book. and I must admit that I did not find an answer by finishing the book. I did not find an answer to the question why was I asked to comment on this book. I'm not an expert on 17th century or 16th century. I know almost nothing on Christian religion and next to zero on political science.
Good, I like it that way.
Okay. So I've decided, with not asking my colleagues, Yedidia and Chanoch, who gratefully invited me, that probably I was asked to comment on this book because they want me to make some comparisons to the experience that we have here in Israel in the last century or in the Zionist era, going back to some Jewish sources, and can we get something there, or should we, and how should we do it? Okay. אוקיי, okay, אז כפי שאמרתי כרגע באנגלית, אני אדבר על הדמיון שבין התהליך התרבותי שעומד בבסיס ספרו של נלסון, ובין התהליכים התרבותיים שעברו עלינו החברה היהודית בארץ ישראל במאה השנים האחרונות. בשני המקרים מדובר בתהליכים חברתיים מהפכניים ורבי משמעות, שגררו בין השאר חיפוש של טקסטים קנונים על מנת לאחוז בהם כדי לייצר בסיס חדש לתרבות. בשני המקרים מדובר באותם הטקסטים בדיוק, בחזרה לעברית ובחזרה לתנ"ך. המעבר של העולם היהודי מקהילה למדינה הוא מעבר רב משמעות. אף שלכאורה זה היה חלום הדורות, אבל יהודים פתאום מגלים שהם לא בטוחים שהם יודעים איך לנהל מדינה. אז אופציה אחת הייתה פשוט לקרוא את הספר של נלסון, ואולי למצוא שיש להם תשובות, אבל כנראה שזה לא כל כך פשוט. והשאלה היא, האם יש לנו מסורת פוליטית, ומהי המסורת הפוליטית שלנו, ומה צריך לעשות, היא לא פשוטה. עכשיו, הדגש בספר של נלסון איננו על ההיבראיזם במובן של חזרה לעברית, אלא על היבראיזם במובן של חזרה לתנ"ך ולמקורות הרבניים. אבל בכל זאת, אני רוצה לפתוח את הדברים דווקא בחזרה לעברית, את הדברים שלי, לאחר מכן נדבר על חזרה לתנ"ך, ובסוף אני אשאל האם יש בכלל מושג כזה של חזרה, האם יש דבר כזה לחזור לאן שהוא, האם אפשר לחזור. ונלסון מתעניין בהיבראיזם במובן הפנים נוצרי. זאת אומרת, מה מנע מן הנוצרים את ההתבוננות בתנ"ך לפני התהליך שמתואר בספר, ומה גרם למהפכה שפתאום יש חזרה לתנ"ך ולמקורות הרבניים. אבל אני רוצה לשאול את אותה שאלה מהיבט פנים יהודי. זאת אומרת, כיצד קרה הדבר שהיהודים לא תרגמו את המקורות שלהם, או לא תרגמו את הספרות שלהם, לשפות שבתוכם הם חיו? לא תרגמו בשביל הנוצרים, אלא מדוע הם לא תרגמו את זה בשביל עצמם? אבל לכאורה, השאלה הזאת היא כפירה בעיקר, משום שאנחנו יודעים שיהודים תמיד כתבו ועסקו רק בעברית. אבל אם נחשוב על השאלה הזאת בתורה קצת יותר מעמיקה, נגלה שהשאלה הזאת איננה כפירה בעיקר. משום שהעובדה היא שהתנ״ך תורגם ליוונית בתקופה כבר מאוד קדומה, ויהודים רבים בעולם היווני קוראים את התנ״ך ביוונית. והתנ״ך לא תורגם ליוונית כפי שאולי היינו רוצים לחשוב בשביל החוצה. הוא תורגם ליוונית בשביל יהודים שלא ידעו עברית. אז מה קרה לתרבות הזאת שנקטעה? כיצד, איך אנחנו יכולים להסביר את העובדה שהקנונים היהודים אינם מתורגמים? יותר מזה אני אומר, שתרגום ה-70 שהזכרתי הרגע, התרגום של המקרא ליוונית, חכמים לא יצאו נגדו. חכמים שייצרו את התרבות המשנה והתלמוד שעליה אנחנו מדברים, לא יצאו נגד התרגום הזה. במשנה, ואני רוצה לצטט משנה, המשנה אומרת, ספרים נכתבים בכל לשון. רבן שמעון בן גמליאל אומר, לא התירו אלא יוונית. ובתלמוד הבבלי מסבירים למה דווקא יוונית, משום מעשד את תלמי המלך, כלומר תרגום ה-70. זאת אומרת, המעשה של תרגום ה-70 נתפס כנס, הוא נתפס כמעשה מוצלח, ואכן בהמשך הסוגיה מסבירים שם, מה טעמו של רבן שמעון גמליאל, דבריו של יפת יהיו באוהלי שם, יפיפיותו של יפת באוהלי שם. אם כן, וברור שאם כך בתלמוד, קל וחומר שכך במקורות היהודיים היווניים הקדומים, באיגרת אריסטאס, ואצל פילון, פילון מספר לנו שיום שתורגמה התורה ליוונית הוא יום חג. אבל למרבה הפלא, או לכאורה, שוב אני אומר, אנחנו לוקחים את העובדה הזאת כמובנת מאליה, כי אנחנו רגילים אליה, וזו שאלה שצריכה להישאל. במשך 1,500 שנה, יהודים נודדים בכל העולם, מדברים את השפות, השפה המדוברת שלהם, הוורנקולר שלהם איננו עברית, ובכל זאת הם מעולם לא מתרגמים את הקנונים שלהם. המשנה עד שהגיעו החבר'ה של נלסון, מעולם לא תורגמה. היהודים, גם אם הם למדו את המשנה שלו בעברית, הם מעולם לא תרגמו אותה, הם קראו אותה רק בעברית. ואיך אנחנו מסבירים את הדבר הזה? אנחנו נחשפים היום למי שמודע לתרבות הארטסקול, שהכל מתרגמים, היהודים מתרגמים הכל בשל עצמם, זו תרבות חדשה, זו איננה תרבות יהודית אותנטית, זה לא קרה במשך כמעט 2,000 שנה, או לפחות 1,500 שנה, זה לא קרה. יתרה מכך, חוץ מחריגים פה ושם, היהודים גם כותבים רק בעברית. זאת אומרת, אין לנו טקסטים יהודיים רבנים. כמעט ואין לנו, יש חריגים ששווה לדבר עליהם, אבל כמעט ואין לנו טקסטים יהודיים שאינם בעברית. מה שאני טוען הוא שהעובדה הזאת היא לא מקרית, אלא היא חלק מפרוגרמה תרבותית מנוהלת ומכוונת ומודעת. אני רוצה לצטט מדרש. זה מדרש תנחומה, כלומר יחסית מאוחר מהמאה השמינית, אבל מצטט חכם בין המאה הרביעית. וכך אומר המדרש. שאמר הקדוש ברוך הוא למשה, כתוב לך. ביקש משה שתהיה המשנה בכתב. אז משה רצה את המשנה כתובה ולא תורה שבעל פה. ולפי שצפה הקדוש ברוך הוא, שאומות העולם עתידים לתרגם את התורה ולהיות קוראים ביוונית, והם אומרים, אני ישראל, עד עכשיו המאזניים מעוין. אמר להם הקדוש ברוך הוא לאומות העולם, אתם אומרים שאתם בניי? איני יודע. אלא מי שמסתרין שלי, מי שהמסתורין שלי אצלו, אלו הם בניי. ואיזו, זו המשנה. כלומר, כל עוד אנחנו מדברים רק על התורה שבכתב אומר לנו מדרש, המאזניים מעוין. יש כביכול שוויון בין ישראל ובין האומות, לעומת זאת, התורה שבעל פה היא המסתרין, היא המייחדת את ישראל, היא הסוד. ומניעת הסוד מן האומות, מניעת הסוד מן האומות, על ידי מניעת התרגום ליוונית, היא האופן של שימור התרבות ושמירת התורה שבעל פה. אז ברור לכולנו שיש כאן תגובה לטענת הכנסייה, הרואה עצמה כיורשת האמיתית של ישראל. המציאות הריאלית היא שכתבי הקודש, ספר הספרים, התנ״ך, איננו עוד של ישראל, העולם הנוצרי אימץ אותו. והמשנה לטענת המדרש היא שמייחדת ומבדלת את ישראל והופכת את היותם לישראל, האוחזים בסוד שהעניק להם הקדוש ברוך הוא. ולפיכך יש לעשות מאמץ לשמר את התורה אך ורק בידיהם של היהודים, על מנת שלא יקרה מה שקרה לתורה שבכתב. אם כן, יש כאן לכאורה איזושהי שאיפה לאיזוטריות תרבותית, שאיפה לשימור התרבות, תרבות מתגוננת. אבל אני סבור שיש כאן במדרש, ואני חושב שזה נמצא עמוק בתרבות הרבנית, משהו הרבה יותר משמעותי. המדרש טוען שאלמלא תורגמה התורה, כלומר המקרא, אלמלא תורגם התנ"ך ליוונית, לא היו הנוצרים יכולים לאמץ אותו. ולא בגלל שהם לא ידעו עברית, אלא הטענה של המדרש היא שהפרשנות הנוצרית למקרא יכולה להתקבל רק למקרא ביוונית. רק הוא סובל את הפרשנות הנוצרית. התנ"ך בעברית לא יכול לסבול את הפרשנות הנוצרית. במילים אחרות, כמו שאין יהדות ביוונית, גם אין נצרות בעברית. זו בעצם הטענה של המדרש. ואכן, עובדה מעניינת שבהקשר של הספרות הרבנית צריך לזכור אותה, שבאותה תקופה שנכתבת הספרות הרבנית, יש לנו קאנון יהודי נוסף. מה שאנחנו קוראים הספרות החיצונית, הספרות האפיגרפית או הפסדאפיגרפית, שנכתב בארץ ישראל באותה תקופה, בעברית, כספרות יהודית, שדומה מאוד למקרא, אבל הספרות הזאת תורגמה מהר מאוד ליוונית, ובסופו של דבר שרדה רק ביוונית, אבל הפכה להיות חלק מהקאנון הנוצרי, ועבדה לחלוטין לקאנון היהודי. אם כן, המדרש שציטטתי עוסק בעוצמת המשמעות של תרגום הקאנון. תרגום זה לא עניין טכני. בתרגום יש אמירה תרבותית עמוקה ורבת משמעות. אחרי שקאנון מתורגם, אומרים לנו חכמים, הוא נקרא בשפתה של התרבות האחרת, שלתוכה הוא מתורגם, ובהכרח כחלק מאותה תרבות. ולטקסט בשפה שונה יש משמעות תרבותית בהקשר הכולל של אותה השפה שעכשיו שבה הוא נלמד. והנוצרים שתרגמו את התנ״ך ליוונית, גם להם יש משמעות לינגוויסטית. ולכן גם הם תרגמו את התנ״ך ליוונית. אני חושב שמי שקורא את פירושו של פילון למקרא, בעברית כמובן, הוא לא זקוק להוכחות החוקרים שפילון קרא את המקרא ביוונית. ומי שקורא את פירושו של שמשון רפאל הירש לתורה, שוב פעם בתרגום לעברית, לא צריך הוכחה שהפירוש נכתב גרמנית במקור. בשני המקרים בולטת העובדה, אף פי שום דבר פירוש יהודי אותנטי, לכאורה. מדובר שהוא שונה מאוד מכל טקסט רבני אחר. הוא נכתב בהקשר תרבותי של השפה שבה הוא נכתב. אם כן, חכמים, לפי מה שאני מציע, כיוונו וניהלו את תרבותם לכל אורך ימי הביניים, לאור התפיסה שרוחה ואופייה הייחודי של תרבות יכולה להישמר רק בשפתה. ואכן, טענת המשנה, ולפי התרגום המשנה ליוונית, היה נס, כפי שראינו קודם, היה נס, וכך ראינו גם בספרות היהודית היוונית, מתהפכת, התמונה הזאת מתהפכת כליל במקורות מאוחרים. והנה, במסכת סופרים, שהיא חיבור בתר תלמודי מן המאה השמינית בערך, אנחנו מוצאים, כך אנחנו מוצאים, מעשה תרגום 70 מתואר כך, והיה אותו יום קשה לישראל כיום שנעשה בו העגל. היום שהמשנה, ראינו אותה כנס. ובמקור קצת יותר מאוחר, מקור יהודי קצת יותר מאוחר, אנחנו מוצאים רשימה של ימי אבל מן תקופת המקרא ואילך, ושם כתוב, אלו ימים שמתענים בהם מן התורה. בשמונה בטבת, מתענים, למה? נכתבה התורה בימי תלמי המלך ביוונית. ונעשה העולם חושך שלושה ימים. אם כן, להחלטתם של חכמים שלא לתרגם את ספרותם, או בנוסף למה שאמרתי, אני אומר צריך לזכור, שלהחלטתם של חכמים שלא לתרגם את ספרותם, היו השלכות מרחיקות לכת, חכמים שילמו על זה מחיר גדול, הם מודעים לזה והם משלמים את המחיר במודע. והמחיר שהם משלמים הוא שלפחות בתקופתם ישנם קהילות יהודיות, אותם קהילות יהודיות שקוראות את התורה ביוונית, שהתרבות של חכמים בלתי נגישה להם. וחכמים מודעים לזה, הם מוכנים לשלם את המחיר הזה משום שהם מבינים שזה הדרך היחידה לשמר את התרבות במובן העמוק של השימור שלה. עוד אולי אנקדוטה שחשוב לציין בהקשר הזה, שקודם לתרגום של הספרות הרבנית, שנלסון מדבר עליה, במאה ה-15, בעיקר ה-16 וה-17, יש לנו גל של תרגום קטעים, לא תרגום מסיבי, כמו מה שנלסון מתאר בספר, אבל יש לנו גל של תרגום קטעים מן הספרות הרבנית במאה ה-11, גם כאן נעשה בעיקר על ידי מומרים יהודיים, אלא שהפעם באופן מרתק, ואני חושב שהשוואה הזאת נורא מעניינת, גל התרגומים של המאה ה-11-12 גורם להתפרצות אנטישמית נוראה בעולם הקתולי. כביכול, הספרות התלמודית שלא הייתה ידועה בכלל בעולם הנוצרי, פתאום נחשפת, והנוצרים פתאום מגלים שהיהודים הם לא סתם אחים מפגרים, שלא ימצאו את הברית החדשה, אלא שיש להם ברית חדשה משלהם, ושהיא אנטגוניסטית או נוגדת לחלוטין את הרעיונות הנוצרים. מה שבכל אופן, אם נחזור לעיקר, החייאת השפה העברית בעידן הציוני איננה למרות שהעברית הייתה שפה מתה, אלא החייאת השפה העברית בעידן הציוני התאפשרה בגלל שהשפה הייתה לא מתה, ולא למרות שהייתה שפה מתה. החייאת השפה בעידן הציוני או במאה ה-20, הייתה הפיכתה לשפת יומיום של חברה לאומית וחברה פוליטית בכל רבדי חייה. ודומני שאין כל ויכוח שמדובר בהישג מופלא, וכי הוא בעצם תנאי הכרחי שאפשר את הקמתה של חברה לאומית וקהילייה פוליטית. וכמובן שלא הייתה כל כוונה לבטל את היותה שפת תרבות גבוהה, אלא להוסיף על כך את היותה שפה מדוברת. עכשיו, אני רוצה להוסיף כאן שני אולמים. אני רוצה להגיד באולם, אבל שני אולמים אני רוצה להוסיף. הראשון אולי פחות קשור לרצף הדברים שלי, אבל אני חושב שחשוב לי לומר אותו, זה בהקשר של החייאת השפה העברית ומשמעותה. אני חושב שניתן לזהות כיום בקרב האליטה התרבותית ובקרב האקדמיה הישראלית, מי ששואפים במודע או שלא במודע, להעניק לעברית של היום את מעמדה של האידי של אתמול. כלומר, עברית כז'רגון, כוורנקולר, אבל לא כשפת תרבות גבוהה. ואילו את מעמדה של העברית, לאורך ימי הביניים, כשפת התרבות הגבוהה, להעניק לאנגלית. מי מכם שעקב לאחרונה אחרי דירוג הפרסומים שהתפרסם בפקולטות למשפטים, אני חושב שקשה היה שלא למצוא שם סאבטקסט שאומר, עברי, אל תפרסם בעברית. חסות הצורך האמיתי והנכון להיות חשוף לביקורת ולהיות שותף למעגלי שיח בינלאומיים, אבל יש כאן אמירה שאין מחובתה של האקדמיה להצמיח תרבות של החברה או לפעול לצמיחתה של התרבות של החברה שבתוכה היא חיה. ואולי יש כאן גם איזושהי שאיפה לטשטש את ייחודה של התרבות העברית, שהרי לאור דברנו, תרבות לא מתקיימת אלא בשפתה ולא יכולה להתפתח אלא בשפתה. העולם השני שאני רוצה לומר על העברית, שלא נועדה להחליף את שפת התרבות הגבוהה, היא לשאול את עצמנו כישראלים על הפרדוקס הבא. הטקסטים העבריים של ימי הביניים, שהיו נגישים לכל יהודי לאור כל אורך ימי הביניים, אף שלא ידע ולא היה מסוגל לדבר עברית, אינם נגישים לנוער שלנו הדובר עברית. איך אנחנו מסבירים את הפרדוקס הזה? התלמידים שלי באוניברסיטה, הרבה יותר קל להם לקרוא טקסט תלמודי באנגלית, מאשר בשפתו המקורית. איך אנחנו מסבירים את הפרדוקס הזה? אז כדי אולי להגיד משהו על זה, אני רוצה לעבור לנושא השני, וזה על החזרה לתנ"ך, או חזרה לתנ"ך דרך הספרות הרבנית. אז תכנס לזה אחר כך. הוגי המאה ה-17 שנלסון דיבר עליהם, ביקשו למצוא בתנ"ך מודל חוקתי ומשפטי ראוי לתפקוד מדינה. לתנ"ך כחוקה פוליטית יש תוקף. החלק הפולחני של התנ"ך איבד את תוקפו, כמו שהרגע אמר לנו פרופסור נלסון, אבל לתנ"ך יש תוקף בהקשרים אחרים, יש לו חשיבות מעבר לזמנו, הוא מציג משטר אידיאלי הראוי לחיקוי. לתנ"ך בחברה הישראלית, לתנ"ך בחברה הציונית, היה תפקיד שונה ואולי הפוך. לא מחפשים בתנ"ך חוקה פוליטית, ולא מחפשים בתנ"ך את אלוהים, ובכל זאת מרתק את ההשוואה בין שתי החזרות הללו לתנ"ך. שני הקשרים שונים, אבל בכל זאת לא אותו טקסט. התנ"ך בחברה הציונית נועד לשקף מציאות של קהילה יהודית לאומית, החיה חיים נורמליים בארצה. הוא נועד להיות האנטיתזה של הגלות המאוסה. יש בו עם שחי חיים לאומיים, יש לו שפה, יש לו היסטוריה, יש לו טריטוריה, יש לו כוח, ואולי בעיקר יש לו אחריות. ואין בו את כל מה שיש לנו כאן בגלות המאוסה. התנ"ך נועד ליצור רציפות לאומית, אבל תוך דילוג, או החזרה לתנ"ך נועדה ליצור רציפות לאומית, אבל תוך דילוג וניתוק הרציפות. והקורא בכתביו של בן גוריון, אולי הבולט שבין המדברים על חזרה לתנ"ך, הקורא בכתביו של בן גוריון אינו יכול שלא להתרשם שבן גוריון מבקש כביכול לאחוז באיזושהי נקודה בהיסטוריה הרחוקה ולהתחיל לכתוב משם מחדש את ההיסטוריה היהודית. לחזור לאותה נקודה ולכתוב מחדש את ההיסטוריה היהודית. ידוע שבן גוריון אהב מאוד את ספר יהושע, הריץ את יהושע כובש הארץ. שמעתי או קראתי את פרופסור גבריהו שאמר שללמוד עם בן גוריון את ספר יהושע היה להבין שבן גוריון רואה את עצמו כיהושע השני, יהושע the second. אבל מי שקורא את כתביו של בן גוריון יודע שבן גוריון לא ראה את עצמו רק כיהושע השני, אלא בן גוריון ראה את עצמו גם, אולי בעיקר, כישעיהו השני. בן גוריון שאף להקים חברה צודקת ברוח חזונו של ישעיהו הנביא. וטענתו של בן גוריון היה, והוא כתב אותה אין ספור פעמים, אי אפשר לחנך דור על הצורך להקים מדינה אחרי שכבר הקמנו אותה. עכשיו צריך לעסוק בחזון, והחזון הוא הצדק החברתי של ישעיהו הנביא. מעמדו של התנ״ך בחברה ההיא של ישראל בשנות ה-60 וה-70 היה חזק ביותר. הייתה לנו בושה לא להכיר את התנ״ך, טיילנו בארץ עם התנ״ך, למדנו פרקי תנ״ך בעל פה, ציירנו את התנ״ך, אימצנו לעצמנו שמות תנ״כיים, והמנהיגנו ציטטו את התנ״ך ודיברו על השאיפה להקמת מדינה ברוח חזון הנביאים. ואז מתעוררת השאלה השנייה, איך הגענו למצב שבתוך זמן קצר כל כך, 2-3 עשורים, התנ״ך לא רלוונטי בחברה שלנו. והייתי אומר, אני חושב באחריות, שהתנ״ך הוא מן המקצועות, ואולי המקצוע, המאוס בבתי הספר שלנו, גם החילוניים וגם הדתיים. אחרי אזרחות, אוקיי. מי שחושב שזה רק בבתי הספר החילוניים, טועה, גם בבתי הספר הדתיים. פרופסור רוטנשטרייך, שהיה רקטור האוניברסיטה העברית, כתב פעם לבן גוריון, כמדומני בתקופתי אותו הרקטור, כתב לבן גוריון, אין קפיצות בהיסטוריה, ולפיכך אי אפשר לחזור לתנ״ך. ענה לו בן גוריון את המשפט הבא ששווה ציטוט. אפשר לקפוץ, ויש קפיצה בהיסטוריה, ומה שעשינו בארץ זו קפיצה על פני ההיסטוריה היהודית. יש קפיצה בחלל, ויש קפיצה בזמן, ואנחנו עשינו את שתיהן. זה, אני חושב, פסינטינג. התנ״ך זורח באור עצמו, אמר בן גוריון, המדרש והתלמוד מאוסים, כתוצר הגלות, נדלג עליהם, נקפוץ אחורה בחלל ובזמן. הגיבור המפורסם של הזז, יודקה, ברוח הדברים הללו, אמר את המשפט האלמותי, לנו אין היסטוריה. מיום שגלינו מארצנה, אנחנו עם בלי היסטוריה. לכו לשחק כדורגל. והגיבור שנחום גוטמן בשנות ה-40 כתב, משישבתי באונייה התחלתי לחשוב למה אני נוסע לארץ ישראל. ועניתי לעצמי, משום שאני רוצה לבוא לארץ שאין בה כלום ולהתחיל הכל מחדש. התנ״ך איבד את מקומו בחברה הישראלית והפך למקצוע מאוס מערכת החינוך משתי סיבות. כך אני מציע. בחינוך החילוני הוא הפך בגלל הניתוק שלו מן הרציפות התרבותית. האוטופיה של חזרה לטקסט עתיק ואימוצו כחוקה לאומית או חברתית היא רומנטיקה רגעית, לא תרבות של עומק. ומסתבר שרוטנשטרייך צדק, אין דבר כזה דילוגים בהיסטוריה. בחינוך הדתי, התנ״ך הפך למקצוע מאוס, בגלל חוסר הנכונות שלנו להיפטר קצת מסבל הירושה. חוסר הנכונות שלנו להניח לפעמים את הקביים בצד, לקרוא שלא, או לפעמים לקרוא את התנ״ך, שלא לאור פרשנות ימי הביניים. חוסר פיתוח כלים לקריאה משוחררת, מחוברת לארץ, למקום שבו אנחנו נמצאים, למציאות שלנו, קריאה של התנ״ך שקורית לפעולה עכשווית. ואם כן, מסתבר שבן גוריון צדק. לפעמים צריך לדלג בהיסטוריה. מי שעוקב אחרי הוויכוח הממש עכשווי בימים האלה, הפולמוס על הוראת התנ״ך כנגד המפקחת החדשה לחינוך הדתי, לחינוך התנ״ך, יודע בדיוק על מה אני מדבר. כן? אם כן, במדרש שבו פתחנו, שהתורה צריכה להיות בעברית, אבל היא צריכה להיות בעל פה. תורה בעל פה מה טיבה? אמרו חכמים, למה בעל פה? כדי שלא יסמוך אדם על הכתיבה ולא ילמוד. כלומר, הזיכרון צריך להיות חי, צרוב בתודעה. אוראליות שמובילה לעמל של זיכרון, לשינון. אבל מנגד אמרו חכמים, למה תורה שבעל פה? כדי שלא לעשות קיום לדורי דורות ולקשור את חכמי עדי הדורות. כלומר, אוראליות שמביאה לחירות ולהתפתחות טבעית, לחיות שמייצרת כל הזמן תאים חדשים. כלומר, יש לנו כאן זיכרון צרוב לעומת גוף חי ומתפתח. שני רעיונות סותרים לחנותין שנמצאים באותו רעיון עצמו של תורה שבעל פה, אני כבר אומר. מסתבר אם כן, שבן גוריון ורוטנשטרייך הם שני הכוחות הנוגדים המצויים בתורה שבעל פה. הם מייצרים ביניהם מתח דיאלקטי שאי אפשר בלי אף אחד מן המרכיבים הללו. ההרמוניה שהם יוצרים היא הליכה קדימה, קריאה רלוונטית של טקסט עכשווית, מקומית, אבל תוך שמירה על רציפות החיים של הטקסט. שאם לא כן, הוא שחוק וזקוק להנשמה, וזה לא הולך. הפירוש החדש חייב להיות לבנה נוספת על החומה הקיימת. ניתוק היכולת שלנו לשוחח עם הדורות בחברה הישראלית, למה אנחנו לא יכולים לקרוא את הטקסט של ימי הביניים, נובע מן התפיסה הדיכוטומית של או-או. או שאנחנו מנהלים דו-שיח של חרשים, אלו שחזרו למקרא ונותקו מן הרצף של התרבות היהודית, ואלה שנשארו בה, אנחנו לא היו מוכנים לאפשר לה לחדור אל המרחב היהודי החדש, מרחב יהודי לאומי ותרבותי, ושני השיחים הללו אינם אותנטיים. משום שליבה של המסורת היהודית התלמודית, וזה הפרק השלישי בספרו של נלסון, שאין בה או-או. התלמוד מייצר תרבות של מחלוקת ושל פלורליזם רעיוני. התלמוד והמדרש הם תרבות של שיח בין דורי. טקסט שבנוי כשאלה ותשובה ששואל החכם מן הדור הבא את החכם מן הדור הקודם ולהפך. ליבו הרעיוני והתרבותי של התלמוד הוא שיחה בין הדורות. התנ"ך מייצר אומנם חזות מונוליטית, אבל האמת היא שזו חזות, וסוד גדולתו וחיותו לאורך השנים היא ביותו רב פנים ורב סתירות. אם כן, התנ"ך הוא מאוד רלוונטי לחברה הישראלית, אבל השאלה היא באמת איזה תנ"ך, האם התנ"ך הדתי או התנ"ך הלאומי או התנ"ך החברתי, האם התנ"ך של בן גוריון שזורח באור עצמו או התנ"ך של המדרש, הדברים שאני אמרתי מוליכים למחשבה שרק התנ"ך שיכול להיות רלוונטי זה התנ"ך שיכול להיות פתוח למתח המחיה שבין כל התנ"כים הללו. הרפובליקה של העברים היא חברה פוליטית, אבל מקורה אלוהי. וזה, אני חושב, ליבו של הספר של נלסון. חברה פוליטית, מקורה אלוהי. משטר ארצי, פוליטי והיסטורי שחוקב מעת האל. זה מתח קשה מאוד ולא פתור. ייתכן שזוהי אחת מעוצמותיו של התנ"ך. אם אתה מסתכל מעבר לחוקיו, הוא פונה אל חברה אנושית הזקוקה לשני המוקדים הללו. היא זקוקה, חברה אנושית שזקוקה לפעולה וזקוקה לצו האלוהי. היא זקוקה לרליגיוזיות וזקוקה לפעולה. חיפוש צדק חברתי, כמו גם בנייתה של חברה פוליטית בריאה, אינו מתנגש עם קרבת אלוהים. זה המסר של התנ"ך. התנ"ך מלא בגיבורים שהם פועלים ומשנים את ההיסטוריה, הם יוצרים, הם מתקנים בכל התחומים. אבל בו בזמן, זה עולם שהאל מנהל אותו. המסורת התלמודית, ובזה אני מסיים, לא עסקה, רק המסורת התלמודית, בדבריו של נלסון, שפרשה את החוקים המקראיים, המסורת התלמודית באמת לעומקה, לא עסקה רק בפרשנותם של הכללים המקראיים, אלא חזרה, אלא יצרה תרבות וחברה, שרוח התנ"ך שורה בה, אבל לא תמיד מתוך אמירות מפורשות. אז אם אני הולך לפי הפרקים של הספר של נלסון, אז יש חברה עם מגוון דעות, ולא רק חלוקות שבטיות, חלוקה שבטית מקראית, אלא תרגום הרעיון למציאות אחרת, חברה עם ויכוח רעיוני. חברה פועלת לצדק חברתי, לא רק במובן של שמיטה ויובל, אלא חברה שקופת הצדקה היא במרכז החיים שלה. חברה שבה המלך או כל מנהיג מחויב ללכת על פי החוק, אולי המעניין ביותר של חוקת המלך בספר דברים, שמשום מה לא נזכר בכתבים של ההבראיסטים ולא מבין למה, אבל החוק שמחייב את המלך לצאת עם ספר התורה לכל מקום שהוא הולך אליו. המלך כפוף לחוק, הוא לא מעל החוק. אם כן, על אף הדיון התלמודי הרחב והמייגע בכללים המשפטיים, רוחו של התלמוד הברורה היא שאי אפשר לבנות חברה מתוקנת שבה הכללים המשפטיים הם חזות הכל. החברה חייבת להעמיד מנהיגים שיודעים לפעול ולהכריע. ירושלים חרבה, אומרים לנו חכמי התלמוד, כי העמידו דינם על דין תורה. הם נתנו את כתב הניצחון, חכמי התלמוד, לרות המואביה על אומץ ליבה לפעול ולשנות את פני ההיסטוריה בניגוד לכללים. בדמיונם של חכמי התלמוד, הם הושיבו את רות המואביה ליד שלמה המלך, ורק בחסותה הוא יכול לפעול. רבי יהודה הנשיא, שעורך הקאנון החשוב ביותר של חכמים, עורך המשנה, מספרים לנו חכמים, ביקש לבטל את חוקי השמיטה. וכשחכמים מחו כנגדו, הוא הביא להם את חזקיה המלך, שכיתת את הנחש של משה, ואמר, לכל אחד יש את הרגע שהוא לובש את הכתר שלו, והכתר שלו זה לפעמים גם להרוס את מה שיש מתוך מחויבות למה שקיים. או מתוך מחויבות לרציפות התרבותית. אם כן, בשעת שינוי ומשבר יש חיפוש וחזרה טבעית לטקסטים קנונים. אבל מסתבר שאין חזרות בהיסטוריה, יש ללכת קדימה. השאלה היא איך אתה מייצר דיאלוג עם הדורות הקודמים ועם הישגיהם ותבונתם.
Whoever decided that he would be the commentator was right about this as well. And before we going to open up for a few brief questions, because we are a little bit short of time, a brief response by Samantha.
Oh, well, that was absolutely fascinating, and there's this huge amount to discuss. So I do want the audience to be able to get in. So I'll just say a couple of very quick things. This contrast in different visions of the Hebrew Republic that you were referring to, citing Ben Gurion in particular, is one that was already present in the 17th century. And that is, you can understand how it would go. You could, by describing ancient Israel, or describing the society described in Tanakh as a res publica, or as a politeia, that is, as Josephus already did, as Philo already did, opens up one of two pathways that you could call it sort of inflation or deflation, right? So the inflationary one is the one I've been talking about, which is you say, well, look, it's a republic, and it's a divinely authorized republic, therefore it is exemplary. It's the most authoritative republic, and we should mold our own politics in such a way as to make them resemble this perfect form as closely as possible. The other way, deflation, is to say, no, it's just another republic. Right? It's just, you know, it's like Sparta or Athens or Rome, and it's a res publica in the same sense, and Moses was a lawgiver, just like Solon or Numa or Romulus or Theseus or whomever, and so we should study ancient Israel just as one normal ancient republic among many, and it's no more or less exemplary for us in the present than the Athens of Solon or the Sparta of Lycurgus or whatever it is, so that's the view you find in Machiavelli, for example. Where he says, look, you know, Moses just appears next to Cyrus and Theseus and so on, just another lawgiver, just another republic. It's normal. So it's a kind of a normal version of national life. But if it's normal, that means it's not special. And then the other view, which is that no, this isn't a republic like any other. It's a republic or a politeia in the sense that we can talk about its having a constitution. But it's a republic that was designed by God and is therefore perfect, exemplary, and fundamentally unlike all of these other ancient republics. And that tension, the tension between the sort of Hebrew Republic as imagined by a Grotius or a Harrington or a Locke, or even, I would say, a Hobbes, as opposed to the sort of Hebrew Republic imagined by a Machiavelli or a Spinoza, already in the 17th century gives you these two pathways, these two very different ways of thinking. The only other thing I'd say is just about translation, and just to second what you were saying. It's absolutely right. I skipped over it because of reasons of time. But the emergence of rabbinic sources into European culture, although it begins in a very fragmentary way, as you said, is earlier, and the impetus behind it is conversion literature, that is, anti-Jewish polemics usually written by converted Jews, the most famous of which is a 13th century text called the Pugio Fide, the Dagger of the Faith, which was written by a converted Jew, and the aim of the text is to use rabbinic sources to argue that the original rabbis had actually accepted Jesus, or something like the story of the Gospels, where it was only the later rabbis who were corrupt and sort of degenerate and had rejected Christ. And so the sort of use of these sources translated, often falsified, in Latin in the earlier period, in manuscripts. These manuscripts circulated very widely, and they provoked these famous disputations, you know, where rabbis, the most famous one is the one involving Nachmanides in Barcelona. But there were many of them in which a rabbi would be asked to debate a Christian theologian. And these texts, as they had been redacted by Christians, were the subject matter of those debates. And so that was the beginning. And these were all either attacks on Jews and Judaism, or they were designed to facilitate Jewish conversion. And so that was the beginning of all of this, although it then explodes. And translation, as you say, was a very dangerous business. I mean, translating these texts into European languages was something, precisely because of this experience, was something that Jews were clearly very, very anxious about. It also was a very difficult and dangerous business to be a Jewish tutor to Christian Hebraists. That is, most of the Jews who taught Protestant Christians their Hebrew were converted Jews, but not all of them. Particularly in by the time you get to the end of the 16th century in the United Provinces, in Holland, in Amsterdam in particular, where you had a large Jewish community and you had Hebrew printing, there was more in the way of exchanges. But when some Christian scholars actually were taught by Jews and had Jewish teachers, there was then enormous pressure on those teachers to convert. And if they refused, they could get in very serious trouble. There's a wonderful recent book, which I'll just, if you're interested in this, by Anthony Grafton and Joanna Weinberg, wrote it together, that's called I Have Always Loved the Holy Tongue. And it's about one of the great Protestant scholars of the century, Isaac Casaubon, who, like Selden, was actually a kind of philo-Semite. He liked Jews. He also liked the Siddur. He liked Tfilah. He had collections of Sidurim in which he was very interested in the Machzor in particular, and he was weird. But he was a Calvinist. So when a Calvinist reads, you know, the Ashamnu prayer, he's so happy he doesn't know what to do with himself. You know, he's pounding away. But you know, but in general, he was a very strange case. But he had a Jewish teacher who was an Italian Jew whose name was Jacob Barnett, who came to Oxford in the early 17th century and taught a number of Hebraists. And he was then under enormous pressure to convert. And when he refused, he was imprisoned and was going to be executed. But Casaubon intervened with the king, with James I, to have him deported, basically, rather than executed. So translation is a very dangerous business. Even teaching non-Jews Hebrew could be a very dangerous business for Jews, and so they were understandably reticent about translation into vernacular languages. But your points about the Greekness of the Septuagint and the sort of fraught questions that it provoked seem to me exactly right and really interesting. So
we have a lot of our table and very little time. So what I suggest, maybe we'll take two or three comments and
please,
then
please.
Get back to you. So the first is Professor Jean Felicia.
The role of the real system in two sense. One, what really happened in the day of the Bible? Can you refer to the reality of the Bible? So can the reality of all of these interpretations throughout, because they influenced by their own reality and their own political theory.
Thank you very much, the two of you. I was thinking about John Selden in the Tower of London with the Talmud, and it reminded me a saying by Rav Menachem Mendel Mikotsk, who is later on, but worth reading, obviously. And he was asking a famous question: what is the difference on what is heaven and hell? And his answer was, it's a room empty with a Talmud. So if you were John Selden, this is not a prison, this is heaven. But if you're an Israeli, this is apparently hell. And my point is, what is the connection between what we're talking here and our project here, human rights and Judaism? And I believe it's a major cultural issue that Arye, I think, hinted. You see, the Jewish language is not here anymore. We have the Israeli language, which is called Hebrew. When I write for Haaretz, the only comments I get from the editor is, your language is too high. That's because I use my own language, which is based on Mishnah, basically. And this is typical for our culture. Now, to Arye, I'm asking, what should we do? Should we bring Israelis to the sources, or should we bring the sources to Israelis? I don't see any other way. If we do the latter, meaning we want to bring in our people to the sources, which we're trying to do here to some degree, then we have to cause these sources to be accessible. And how do you do it without some kind of translation, some kind of change of language, some kind, maybe even more so, of indexation? There is no index for the Jewish bookshelf. Obviously, you're right, we will lose a lot. It might be like reading it in Greek. But what is the right attitude to our generation? We cannot afford neglecting the issue.
First thing I'd like to open that I was really utmost impressed by really this comprehensive scholarship that extends over vast fields, and it's really a model, I think, you know, from Latin and Roman, and especially that you function also as a philosopher, not only a history of the of political philosophy, but I would like, my question is your book essentially is a work really of the history, right? It's a historical analysis, the influence of the Jewish sources on the Republican. We read the chapter about the distributional theory. And my question to you is not as wearing a hat of a scholar of the history of political philosophy, but on your second cap as a political philosopher. As I read also your article from Pioneer Goods to Capabilities, in which you critique Nussbaum.
You're the one.
No.
And your mother.
Nussbaum, Sen, Rawls, and so means you're not in the Department of History. You're in the Department of Government. And I would like to ask you the following. Do you think, this question pertains to some of us around the table that in this project, trying to create this discourse between text and really theory, contemporary theory, do you think that these sources, just like as they functioned in the 16th and 17th century, it seems like as a source, it doesn't seem that they picked out only rabbis, because it seems like that the Reformation, make them confront these texts, and the texts really actually did something to them. It's not that they had these theories, and then they just, even everyone sticked it to his rabbis of his camp. So do you think there's still a potential, not only just like the same process that happened in the 16th, 17th century in Europe, can it happen today? That means that these sources can be a source of a contemporary distributional theory. Yeah, let's say in this context, yeah. What do you think of it? Is it relevant? I think that's one of the things. I think again, if we're talking about things in Israeli society, there's a question about, and there are opinions on both sides. I would like to hear your opinion.
Okay. Well, those are really all wonderful questions. On the point about history and circumstances, both their own circumstances and how they saw the actual sort of historical experience of these people. On the second point, this is also the period, and it's in some degree the same cast of characters who are also the first antiquarians. That is, these people who are sort of going back and writing what they at least understand to be sort of historical reconstructions of ancient societies, one of which is ancient Israel, and Of course, they have lots of reasons for this, but you know that they one of the probably the most important one, as you can probably guess, is that they wanted to understand the primitive church. So the question of the original form of the church government amongst the disciples after the death of Jesus, there the question of whether the apostles did or did not follow Jewish law, all of that was very important in the debates between Catholics and Protestants, between different groups of Protestants, and so they were, in fact, in many ways, asking questions that are only now being asked after, you know, so there's an amazing experience of cultural forgetting that, that took place in between 1700 and 1950, where suddenly now everybody is interested again in the world of classical scholarship, the history of late antiquity, the history of the early church. Everybody's now interested in the rabbis again because, like Selden and Casaubon and all these others, they've concluded that, you know, if you want to understand, you know, what Jesus ate at the Last Supper or whatever, you have to, you know, this is where you look. Or if you, and they begin to notice that a lot of the sayings that that Jesus offers in the Gospels are rabbinic, and you know, so this is now back in, after, you know, 300 years. So it's they were very interested in trying to reconstruct the actual history. How well they did is a different story, but they were very interested. Their own circumstances, and this gets to your point, you know, there is there, when you look at the arguments that they're making, it isn't as naive as people who have no views of any kind and suddenly they read a bit of Masechet Sanhedrin and suddenly they're, you know, they're in business. But I think you're right, and you know, just to put your questions together, it's neither is it a case of figuring out in advance, for different reasons, what it is they want, and then just finding useful sources that they can throw at the problem. Right? It's in between. You know, they're bringing something to the table, but they're also taking from these sources, and they're in dialogue with them, and they're coming to views that, on the one hand, certainly views that they would have found unimaginable in many cases, even a few years earlier. So someone like Milton or Harrington, I mean, it would have been unthinkable for them to argue in 1640 the way they were arguing in 1650. But that doesn't mean it was opportunistic. You know, they went through a political crisis, and they were also reading these sources, and they were in dialogue with them in these, you know, in these very interesting ways. So yes, I mean, I think it's sort of in between. You know, it's as is usually the case. You know, we talk about the recovery of Aristotle in the 13th century. Well, Aristotle didn't just drop from the sky, you know, into the laps of people who were sitting around waiting for Aristotle, and you know, concluding we couldn't figure out what to say about politics until we recovered the lost works of Aristotle. They had already their views, and they had their experiences, and they then had a new source to think about, and there were monarchist Aristotelians and Republican Aristotelians and all the rest, and it's. And so it's, as always, I think, in the history of ideas, it's not that the sources are doing all of the work, and it's not that they're doing none of the work. It's sort of in the middle. And I'll get back to your question about the contemporary point. Yes. So I feel as a non-Israeli, I should keep my nose out of this one. But yes, I mean, you know, we are dealing, I think, with a different. A completely different world, and a story that I told at one point was that when I was working on the book, this book, I was in my office at Harvard, and my computer froze as I was typing, and I'm not particularly good with computers, so it froze, and I did the usual things that I do, and that's I hit it, and then I gave it a timeout, you know, I walked away, and then I came back, and when, you know, so I'd exhausted my repertoire, and then I called down to technical support, and they sent up a man with a kippah to fix the computer, and he walked in, and he's walking into Professor Nelson's office, and, you know, this is not exactly a Yiddish name. Yeah. And so he walks in, and he comes over to my desk, and he's playing around with the computer, and he looks down, and he sees that I have a copy of Masechet Sanhedrin on my table. And he looks up at me, and he says, "Oh, you're Jewish." And I thought, you see, in the 17th century, this would have been an impossible conversation, right? I mean, you know, if you had walked into the office of a nice Protestant scholar named Nelson, you know, in 1650, and found, you know, the last thing on earth you would have assumed was that, that he was a Jew, just because he had the Talmud on his desk. They all had the Talmud on their desk. So on the one hand, you've had this this rather unfortunate phenomenon where the study of Jewish sources has been sort of ghettoized in the domain of Jewish studies, and done overwhelmingly by Jews, such that now it's a perfectly reasonable guess. If you walk into somebody's office, he, you know, doesn't have a Jewish-sounding name, but he has a Talmud on his desk. It's a reasonable guess. And it wouldn't have been in the 17th century. So on the one hand, you have that, and then you have this very unfortunate kind of fissure between those Jews who do and don't have any exposure to these sources, such that their familiarity with them either does or doesn't inflect their thought or their language. My own view is this is unfortunate. I have this experience with my family here all the time because, as we've established, my spoken Hebrew is pathetic. So they, on the one hand, you know, they find it absolutely ridiculous that I can't follow simple conversations, that it takes me, you know, a minute to understand that when they're talking about kochavim, they could mean Hollywood stars. And I'm just thinking, kochavim, you know. But, you know, when then one of them says, azenoravayom, and I say, "Oh, you mean like Unatana Tokev?" And they say, "What?" You know. So we have exactly this issue, and I think it's very interesting. I feel your pain. I'll just put it that way. I feel your pain. On the point about contemporary theory, you know, this is a big question. And it's very difficult, and obviously it sort of depends where you start. So if you're a Rawlsian kind of public reason theorist, then the answer is obviously no. But since I'm not a Rawlsian public reason theorist, I think in principle, the answer is yes. I think we can be open to arguments that we find persuasive wherever they are, and the fact that an argument appears in Plato, or appears in the Mishnah, or appears in Kant, is at least all of a piece to me. I think in principle, they're all admissible arguments to be judged on the merits. I don't myself take any view of the sort of public reason kind that the sorts of arguments you make in political life have to be that we have to sort of have the ambition of making them, entirely rational, ecumenical in the way that Rawls wants, not least because I think it's impossible. That is, I think the idea of public reason as a kind of normative requirement for political discourse is impossible and kind of self-defeating. That is, I don't think that the sorts of claims that a Rawlsian would make are any more or less controversial from the point of view of comprehensive claims of the good life than claims that are drawn from religion or anything else. I mean, I think they will exclude, a Rawlsian conception, no matter what Rawlsians say, will exclude many comprehensive conceptions of the good life, as do other ways of thinking about politics. So on those grounds, I mean, they might be good arguments, they might be bad arguments, we might be persuaded, we might not be, but I don't see in principle a barrier that would prevent us from taking seriously these kinds of sources. Yeah.
Some of us will stay afterwards and converse some more. Others, those who had their earphones, would leave them on their tables, and all of us will thank our guest of honor.